Hi guys, welcome back to my YouTube channel. So today I have my sister, Kemi Oloye. She's a mortgage broker at Just Mortgages. So I'll leave her info on the screen here. You can contact her if you are in need of a broker. Today we're going to talk about shared ownership. It's actually shared ownership week, and so I thought it was quite fitting to do this video, and I'll get back to you as soon as possible. But yeah, so basically we're going to talk about what shared ownership is, some pros and cons, how it differs to a regular mortgage. So Kemi, do you want to introduce yourself?
Okay, so as Tenny said, I'm Kemi. I have been a mortgage broker for over 7 years now. I've worked for some of the major high street lenders, and I've been a broker before, and I'm back to brokering. Genuinely love what I do. I love the challenge. I specifically specialise with clients who have had some form of adverse credit. What I find is that with a lot of young people, I guess when you get into university and they offer you the overdrafts and the student accounts and things like that, or you're in shared accommodation, a bill hasn't been paid, I come across a lot of unpaid bills or CCJs and things like that. So I like the challenge, and what I love is that I never say no, because I don't know, in my opinion, there's always a lender out there who's willing to take a chance. So I guess that's me in a nutshell, and I love all things tea and yeah.
Oh yeah, well I'll leave a link as well, because Kemi does a lot of breast cancer, check your boobs, check your teacups, so I'll leave a link below as well to her personal channel regarding that. But we'll get into shared ownership now. So great, Kemi, do you want to explain what shared ownership actually is?
Okay, so shared ownership, it's so in a sense that you are buying your own house. So if, say for instance, you were buying like your house, you would buy 100% of it. With shared ownership, you're buying a percentage of the property. So let's say the property is on the market for £100,000 and you're buying a 25% share, you'd be paying 25% for the mortgage. So your purchase price would be £25,000.
And then you get the mortgage on the 25k rather than...
Yeah, so your mortgage would be on the 25,000, and then you'd pay rent on the remaining 75%. So it's, I guess with shared ownership, it's a great way to get your foot on the property ladder. It's also a cheaper way because your mortgage is lower, but I guess one of the other things to bear in mind is that you are paying rent on the remaining 75%.
So in terms of those who are eligible for shared ownership, you could be a first-time buyer, you could have owned a property in the past but now can't afford to, so you're going to use the shared ownership method instead, or you could currently be in a shared ownership and you want to move to another one. So those are the three types of people who can do it. So it essentially doesn't exclude many people. However, I do believe that a lot of boroughs or the scheme itself has some clauses in terms of affordability, so it's somewhat means tested. If you're outside London, you have to earn 80k or less, or if you're in London, it's 90k or less. So just to note that. Also, as Kemi mentioned, you're purchasing a share of the property, and that's usually between 25% to 75%. All right, so Kemi, do you want to explain to us what the mortgage process is like? I'm not quite sure if it's very different from a standard mortgage, but how does it differ for you?
Okay, the mortgage process for me is it takes a little bit more longer than your average purchase. And the reason being is that for someone who is buying with the shared ownership scheme, you've got to pass the criteria of the housing association as well. And then there's also a shared ownership calculator that you've got to use. This is something that you can find on the gov.co.uk website as well, or the Help to Buy website. But there's a calculator where you have to put in all of your income, your outgoings, whether you're paying student loan, your credit cards, payments, everything is on there. And you have to, in a sense, you have to meet all the criteria that's there, and I believe that it's your total debt in comparison to your net income can't exceed 45%. I'll get Tenny to put the link of the calculator there. So yeah, so we do the calculator, and then I've also got to do my own calculations as well. So I've got to make sure that the mortgage is affordable with the lender also. So even though it's a small mortgage that most people are getting, I still need to factor in the shared ownership rent as well. So when I'm doing the calculators for different lenders, I'm putting in the anticipated mortgage amount, I'm putting in the anticipated shared ownership rent, and also ground rent and service charge. So normally when I'm calculating mortgage affordability, I look at your outgoings in terms of your monthly commitments, such as loans, credit cards, hire purchases, and things like that. With shared ownership, on top of all of those, I'm also looking at, I'm counting the service charge on ground rent as a commitment, and also the rent as a commitment. So when you look at your outgoings on a calculator, it's going to be super high. So if you're on a low income and then we're trying to work it out, a lot of the times that's when I get a bit stuck. Okay, so once I've done all the calculations and I see that this looks like it could work out, what I then do is look at the lender who A is offering a shared ownership product, and then look at their criteria. I always say to clients when I first meet them that I'm not a rate chaser. I deal with criteria, I look at the whole picture, and then I then find the top three lenders who I know that your case could most likely sit with, and then I look at who's got the lowest rate with the top three.
Right, so firstly you're looking at whether you would actually be accepted by the lender before you go and chase any rates, and then the application gets rejected and that can impact your credit score. So really you're trying to help the individuals not get rejected and have marks on their credit.
Exactly, history. Yeah. I think that a lot of people get caught up in seeing these really low rates.
Yeah, yeah.
And for me, yeah, there are low rates out there, but if you don't meet the criteria, then the rate is irrelevant.
Mm-hmm.
So I like to look at the whole picture first, and then I see where it's most likely going to fit. But I mean, if on paper it's absolutely perfect and you've got great income, you've got no outgoings and everything, then hey, yeah, we'll look at the rates. But with shared ownership, I guess one of the reasons why you're going down the shared ownership route is because you've got lower income and your affordability doesn't meet what that you want to do anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. So just to mention as well, in terms of the rent that you pay on the portion that you do not own, so the portion that's owned by the housing association, is usually up to 3%, but it depends on the housing association or the council that you're purchasing from, so it varies. So when you're going through the process, what type of documents do you request from people who are looking to get into shared ownership? Not sure if it's any different to a regular mortgage or...
No, it's pretty much the same, to be honest with you. The only thing that I would ask for that's different is the information about the housing association, because I like to do a little bit of research on who they are, what their terms and conditions are, because I guess with most people who buy shared ownership, in the long term they'd want to staircase and buy more shares. So I want to see whether there's, you know, whether they've got any stipulations in their terms and conditions as to how long it would you'd have to wait and things like that, just so that I can have a whole rounded conversation with you. So I would ask for, actually this is something that I've recently started doing since coronavirus, I've started asking for everyone's credit file before I even do anything. And the reason being is that as of corona, lenders are very, very strict now on missed or late payments, whereas before they could take a view on it, we could write a memo to say this is what happened. Now they are very strict with any missed or late payments within the last 12 to 24 months. So I always ask for the credit report, because what I found from my experience is that some people just aren't as forthcoming. I think they think that if I don't say anything you won't know.
They find out.
Okay, so in summary, what I ask for is 4 months bank statements, 3 months payslips, proof of ID, so that's your passport or your driving license, proof of address, a utility bill dated within the last 3 months. Obviously, there are some people who are first-time buyers who live at home with mum and dad, so sometimes they don't pay any bills, so a bank statement would be used for proof of address. And then if you do have any outstanding balances on credit cards, I normally like to see the last statements, but sometimes it's not the be all or end all, because if you've given me your credit file, then I'd know what your outstanding balances are. And then also proof of deposit. So whether the deposit's coming from yourself or whether it's a gifted deposit, if it's a gifted deposit, then I'd need the gifted deposit letter, I'd need the ID of the person who it's coming from. But other than that, that's it. As the case progresses, if it turns out that I do need some more information, then I'll just ask as and when, but those are the key things that I need up front.
So you mentioned staircasing. For those of you who don't know, can you please define what staircasing is?
Yeah, so staircasing is, for example, you've purchased 25% of the property and then you've taken a 2-year fixed. In 2 years' time, you've hopefully you've got an increase in your salary and then you want to buy another 25%. It could be you could buy 50% more, it could be that you go all the way up to 100. So basically you're purchasing more shares of the property. The housing association that you purchase from will say whether it can be increments of 25 or whether it has to be increments of 50. But you know, if there's
that
got...
percent, 50% or
yeah, percent. Okay. Yeah, percent. So staircasing is pretty straightforward. I guess the only, for me personally, the only downside of it is that you would need to pay for an independent valuation of the property. So you're spending about £300, sometimes more, on someone on an independent person to come out and value the property. And then that's the price that you have to purchase it at. So it doesn't matter what X, Y, and Z has sold for next door or what it's on the market for, whatever that survey comes back at, that's what you're buying at. It does involve solicitors again, because remember, when you're purchasing a property and you have deeds of your, whether it's a house or a flat, on the deeds it will say the housing association has an interest in 75%, because you would have bought at 25% at the outset. So again, you're gonna have to pay solicitors to change the deeds as well. So you pay the solicitors for their service, you then have to pay for it to be changed at land registry as well. I guess one of the good things that I've found with staircasing is that if you buy in the right area, if say in two years later, what you then can do is use the equity that you've now built up in your share to use that to staircase as well. So you don't really use much of your own money. But again, every case is different and it is subject to lending criteria at the time.
Okay, so that's really good actually. Kemi's kind of mentioned some cons as well as a pro. I think another pro is obviously that it can be at times cheaper than renting outright. That's obviously depending on your calculations and how much you're purchasing, but that is a possibility, and obviously it also helps you get your foot onto the ladder if you wouldn't be able to purchase 100% as though you would in a normal mortgage. So those are some pros and cons. Okay, so in terms of how to apply, shared ownership is basically a form of help to buy, so you would have to go to your local help to buy agent, and then if you look at the government help to buy website, it gives you information on how you should apply. It may differ in different locations, local authority. So I will put the link for the government website right here. You can check it out if shared ownership is something that you are interested in. And yeah, that's the end of the video. Thank you so much for joining me, Kemi.
You're welcome.
Thank you. We'll be doing more videos soon. Don't forget to subscribe and press the like button and put the bell on as well so that you can get notified when I upload a video, because I think you all kind of know now that I don't have a regular schedule, but you want to keep up to date in terms of what's going on in housing. So subscribe, guys. Thank you very much for watching again, and have a great day. Whenever time you're watching this, but bye.
Okay, yeah, bye.